Today's video is about the diamond necklace affair, in French, the affaire du collier de la reine. It's a scandal that played out at the French court in the 1780s. The event is of historical importance because it was one of the indirect reasons for the French Revolution. Find out in today's video what happened. For years, Parisian jewelers Boehmer and Bassange had collected diamonds for a necklace that King Louis XV wanted to give to his mistress, Madame du Barry. However, he died before the transaction was completed. After the death of Louis XV in 1774, the jewelers offered the necklace to Louis XVI as a gift for his wife, Marie Antoinette. Because of the high price of 1.6 million livres, and because it had been previously offered to Madame du Barry, whom Marie Antoinette despised, the king and Marie Antoinette refused. She said that the money would be better spent on state affairs instead of on the necklace. After this, the jewelers tried to sell the necklace abroad, in particular to the Sultan of Turkey, which ultimately failed. After the birth of the Dauphin, Louis Joseph, in 1781, the necklace was once again offered to Marie Antoinette. Again, she refused to buy it. The refusal of the queen placed the jewelers in great financial distress, as the creation of the necklace had left them nearly bankrupt. Marie Antoinette remained adamant that she would not buy the necklace and advised the jewelers to dismantle it and sell the diamonds separately. Cardinal Louis-René Édouard de Rohan, the Bishop of Strasbourg and former ambassador to Vienna, tried to gain favor with the queen at the time, in order to become prime minister. Marie Antoinette did not like the cardinal because during his ambassadorship in Austria, he spoke negatively about Marie Antoinette to the Austrian Empress Marie Theresia, who was the mother of the queen. The cardinal's ambitions to gain favor with the queen were discovered by Jeanne de Saint-Rémy de Valois, the Countess de La Motte Valois. De La Motte Valois was a descendant of an illegitimate child of King Henry II and usurped the title of Countess. In 1784, she put herself in touch with Cardinal de Rohan and told him that she had met the queen and was a favorite of hers at court. However, the queen and de La Motte had never met. The cardinal, oblivious to the fact that de La Motte Valois did not know the queen, decided to use the countess's services so he'd get into the queen's good graces. De La Motte Valois offered to speak highly about the cardinal in front of the queen in exchange for money. This was the beginning of an exchange of letters between de Rohan and, as he believed it, the queen. In reality, Louis-Marc-Antoine Rétaux de Villette wrote the forged letters of Marie Antoinette. As the tone of the letters became more and more friendly, the cardinal was bold enough to ask the countess if she would arrange a meeting with the queen. De La Motte Valois agreed and arranged a meeting on August 11, 1784, in the gardens of the Palais de Versailles between 10 and 11 at night. De La Motte had enlisted the help of a young stage actress, Madame Leguet, Baronet d'Oliva, who bore some resemblance to the queen. During the rendezvous of de Rohan with the actress, the impostor queen told the cardinal that as queen she was willing to forget all past disputes. With the money that the Countess de La Motte Valois had received from the cardinal for her so-called interventions with the queen, she was able to mingle among the elite of Paris, where she convinced many aristocrats that she was indeed a favorite of the queen. This information was also heard by the jewelers Boehmer and Bassange, who approached her and asked her to intercede with the queen to buy the necklace, to which she agreed. On January 21, 1785, the countess informed the jewelers that the queen indeed wanted to buy the necklace, but that it had to be done discreetly by an intermediary, the Cardinal de Rohan. Hence, de Rohan, still oblivious to the betrayal, began negotiations with the jewelers and convinced them, having the power of attorney from the so-called queen, that the agreed-upon amount for the necklace would be paid in 4 installments, provided the jewel was handed over before the first payment. He took the necklace to the countess's house, where an envoy from the queen was ready to receive the jewel and hand it over to the queen. In reality, however, the envoy was no other than the husband of the countess, Count de la Motte Valois. He disappeared with the necklace and soon after started to sell the stones abroad. When the first payment term expired and Cardinal de Rohan was unable to meet his obligations to the jewelers, Boehmer turned to Marie Antoinette. The queen, unaware of what had transpired, replied that she did not have the necklace, nor that she ever ordered it, upon which the king and queen were informed about the details of what had happened. In August 1785, the Cardinal de Rohan and the Countess de la Motte Valois were arrested in quick succession. Normally, the affair that greatly discredited the queen would have been settled in silence, but in her naivety, the wronged queen demanded that the cardinal, whom she still disliked immensely, be tried publicly. The process was followed by the public and, due to unfavorable pamphlets printed, the public turned against the queen. During the trial by the Parliament of Paris on May 31st, 1786, the cardinal was acquitted but exiled to his abbey of La Chaise Dieu. Countess de la Motte was sentenced to whipping, branding, and life imprisonment. It is generally assumed that Marie Antoinette is hardly to blame in this story and that the Cardinal de Rohan was an innocent, naive victim of de la Motte Valois. However, Marie Antoinette was already extremely unloved in the streets of Paris due to her wasteful lifestyle and Austrian origin. The sensational trial made it widely believed that she had used de la Motte Valois to take revenge on the cardinal for badmouthing her at the Viennese court. The scandal therefore seriously damaged the reputation of Marie Antoinette and the monarchy. Thus, it became an important factor for the anti-monarchist mood that was growing in France, which would make the French people ready for the revolution in 1789. This concludes part 2 of the 2-part series about Marie Antoinette. In my last video, we will discuss her trial and execution, so please subscribe and hit that notification bell so you won't miss it. See you all then!